Well, my brother and I, sitting on a tropical beach, watching a dog walk by, and we just asked the question, you know, what is that dog? It's a key population because it's the most numerous population of carnivores in the world. So there's a billion dogs on the planet, and 3/4 of them are village dogs.
Today we're at Cornell University in Ithaca, New York, to meet Adam Boyko, an assistant professor at the Faculty of Veterinary Medicine.
He's recently published a very cool paper about dog domestication.
So, did we domesticate dogs, or did they domesticate us?
You know, that's a really good question, and I'm sure that he's got a lot to say about that.
Hi, Adam.
Hi, Irene. How's it going?
Good. How are you?
Hey, Jacques. Thanks for coming.
Good to see you.
So, who do you have here?
I have Sam. He's a gorgeous yellow Labrador retriever. He's our latest volunteer in the genetic diversity study.
I hear we're going to take some genetic samples from him.
That's right. We're going to put him in the biobank, and we're going to look at his DNA.
What are you expecting to see?
Well, for Sam, I know that he has short fur. I know that he's got yellow fur, so I know he's homozygous for FGF5 and for TYRP1. TYRP1 is the B locus in dogs, and it's the same locus in humans that causes blonde hair.
Oh, that's really cool.
He's also a little on the small side for a Labrador, so I'm expecting he has at least one copy of the small IGF-1 allele.
Labs get hip dysplasia like other big dogs.
That's right. Having samples from healthy dogs like Sam to compare with the dogs that we see in the clinic is really important for finding the genetic predispositions for diseases like that.
What's the sampling process?
Well, we use these saliva swabs. Sam, ready? Ready for your sample? Here we go. Open up. Don't eat the swab. Don't eat the swab.
I think you got plenty there.
Yeah. There we go. Thank you, Sam.
Adam, we've now collected the sample, so how do you analyze it?
Well, we extract DNA from that swab in the lab, and then we put the DNA on a genotyping array.
How do you relate all of this back to the clinical usefulness?
Knowing the genes that predispose for risks of these diseases also gives us ideas for ways to treat the disease and might offer us insights for treating homologous diseases in people.
So are there breeds that are specific for each disease?
Yeah, so we see very high rates of cancer, for instance, in golden retrievers.
I see they've found markers for pointing behavior.
Yeah, we would love to uncover the genetic basis for all these different behaviors, you know, not just for being able to improve our breeding of working dogs, but also our understanding for how the brain works. For example, most of the behaviors we associate with hunting dog breeds are all modified from the prey drive behavior that wolves have. And so pointers orient towards the prey, but they don't charge towards the prey. Herders will charge towards the prey, but they don't bite the prey. Retrievers will bite the prey, but they won't consume the prey.
So Adam, here we have a Siberian wolf, the dog's ancestor. And here we have an extreme of breeding, which is the English bulldog. How many genetic variations are between the wolf and a dog like this?
Surprisingly, you're talking about maybe a few dozen genes. When wolves became domesticated into dogs, they didn't immediately start looking like this. So they had to go through this domestication process where we had strong natural selection to become tame. Following that selection for tameness came more selection for a new diet that they had, and smaller body size and smaller canine teeth and less of a sagittal crest here for attaching chewing muscles, then people could start selecting for whatever traits they wanted in their dogs. And it really took off in the Victorian era when they started pedigree breeding. And so when you look at purebred dogs, you have more selective sweeps, but this time for morphological traits, such as extreme size, small or large.
What is a selective sweep? Can you explain it to us?
So when you have a variant that becomes positively selected in a population, over time, that variant becomes more and more common until it's completely, what we say, swept through the population, and every individual now is fixed for that variant. Not only the selected variants, but all the other variants that happen to be on the chromosome.
And those could be disease genes?
In some cases, those can be disease genes. In a case like this, we call it genetic draft, where it's like a race car drafting alongside another one. And that is also a real problem for genetic disease in dogs.
How many sweeps do you see?
I mean, there's been about 36 sweeps at domestication, turning a wolf into a village dog. And then depending on the breed, you probably have another dozen or so sweeps.
So what are you learning about dogs, dog breeds, and diseases?
Doberman Pinschers have canine compulsive disorder. So a large number of them compulsively, you know, bite at their paws or chew blankets. We actually see it's the same gene that causes obsessive compulsive disorder in people. So in fact, the dogs probably are obsessing, but we just don't know it because we can't ask them.
So what was your inspiration to start looking at the village dogs?
There was this debate about where dogs originated. Trying to figure that out by looking at purebred dogs is like trying to figure out human origins by sequencing all the royal families of Europe. Village dogs contain more of the variation that was present in our earliest dog ancestors, and therefore can be used to infer what happened early on in domestication in dogs.
What did you find from that?
What we found is that there is a center of diversity in Central Asia in the village dogs, and so that makes Central Asia a likely domestication origin for the dogs.
What gets you excited about this work?
Well, what gets me excited now is that as the genomic tools are getting better and better, we're going to start to be able to go get the roots of complex disease, you know, things like cancer, things like hip dysplasia, to improve dog health as well as human health.
I was really surprised in learning how much dogs share with us, not only our environment, but also so many genetic factors.
And the more we can know about improving the dog's health, the more we know about improving human health.